Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this exciting discussion on marketing at the base of the pyramid. I am Arijit Basu, Regional Director for Markets for the Global Alliance for Clean Cookstoves, and have been in the private sector most of my life. It's just been a few years that I moved from the private sector to the social sector. Worked in glorious organizations like Nestle, Heinz, Gillette, Duracell, GlaxoSmithKline, to name a few, all blue chip, multinational, fast moving consumer good companies. Just to take you through the various disruptive innovations and strategic ideas from various organizations which has worked over many years and help build mighty brands through great marketing and marketeers. So some of the thing which I would like to share with you is early days, let's say in India, organizations like Eveready Batteries would have their van operations in specified routes that would go down up to a 5,000 population town and distribute their products to the people at the base of the pyramid. Couple of years back, the smaller SKUs, as we call it, the stock keeping units in the fast moving consumer goods industry, was a revolutionary find. Single serve of shampoos, single serve of edible oils, hair oil, helped penetrate the market in the smallest of towns and villages of some of the Asian geographies. Some of the organizations created the hub and spoke model, where the large distributor would have sub-distributors spread across geographies in their respective regions. About 3 years back, when I moved into the social sector, I was actually the country director of a reputed social enterprise called Living Goods, based out of Uganda. One of the things that we introduced in that country, which really worked very well with micro entrepreneurs, was the mobile platform, passing on real-time marketing information to the various micro entrepreneurs for faster response and action. The door delivery model of Living Goods, which was adopted by the Avon group of people, worked wonderfully in some of the markets where it was inaccessible to take your vehicle or to take your van because of road, because of infrastructure issues. I was talking the other day to one of the organizations where people are today thinking of marketing their products through drone delivery. Some of the e-commerce organizations are the ones which I'm talking of, where the drones will one day be finding their way with the products at the household of the end consumer. Let us now move to some of the other innovations which has worked very well in terms of marketing at the base of the pyramid. Let's say, for example, the weekly market activation. When I was in Uganda, we were doing some mapping studies of some of the landing sites which exist across that country. A landing site is actually a place where you have the fishermen coming in with their proceeds, they sell their products, and earlier days they would take that money back with them to their remote villages and remote corners of their geography where they stay. So what I found out from there, that every landing site had a weekly day where there would be the fish sales, and on that day we would send the cook stoves with our micro entrepreneurs between 10 in the morning to around 5 in the evening. And at the end of the day, the micro entrepreneurs would be so happy to see that all the cook stoves that they had taken at that landing site had got sold off. So this basically means being with the right product at the right place. People had the option, instead of taking back money to their villages, which could be unsafe, they took back products with them to their various villages and their homes. If you take a country like India, we just found out that there are more than 250,000 post offices which are gradually getting redundant because of the technology. Very few people have been going to the government post offices to send money. Very few people have been going to the post offices to send out letters. So to make themselves viable, these post offices actually have lent out their space to fast-moving consumer good companies like Unilever to distribute their products from those outlets. So here was a ready-made infrastructure which was there, which some of these FMCG stalwarts and brains used very efficiently to spread their product across the length and breadth of the country, like India. There are many examples which we can continue with, but I would like to probably conclude in the next 2 minutes. There's one another example which I would like to share with you is the public distribution system channel that we have in a country like India. There are 500,000 private public distribution systems, which are channels which are available. These are called the fair price shops. These are meant for people at the base of the pyramid. These are meant for people at the socio-economic level C and D. Most of these fair price shops, they retail rice, oil, some basic products. And here there was an opportunity that we saw. If we could introduce the cook stoves, which is so difficult to distribute and so challenging at the base of the pyramid, here is an infrastructure which can probably help us to reach this product at an arm's distance of the consumer. So these are some of the various innovations, disruptions, big bang thoughts, outside the box thinking which the marketeers have done and reached their product to villages, to towns, even below 5,000 population. So without taking any more time as a moderator, I actually get excited because I am from the private sector, so whenever there is a topic like this, I always feel like sharing some of this experience which could be helpful for the audience. But without wasting any more time, I would like to introduce you to our the panel and the speakers who are sitting out here. Barbara Asumadu comes from Fidelity Bank, and she will briefly be talking about her when I hand over the mic to her after some time. Then we have Peggy Dibby, who is the head of corporate communications and public affairs of Nestle in Ghana. Then we have Pragnesh Mishra, who is the country director of Avalon Clean Energy for Ghana and West Africa. So there is a fantastic cross-section of people sitting across, from the banking sector, from the fast-moving consumer goods sector, from the clean energy sector, who would take you through their thoughts, take you through their experiences, that what are some of the benefits, some of the challenges, some of the successes that they have attained over time through innovative marketing at the base of the pyramid. So I would just hand over the mic to Pragnesh, and then you can hand it over to you, yeah, and then to I think after the introduction is over, Pragnesh, you can start with your experience, and then Fidelity Bank, and then Nestle. Thanks.
Good morning, everybody. I am Pragnesh Mishra. As Arjit already introduced us, I would be sharing you about how we are trying to promote the clean fuel and the clean cook stove to reach at the base of the pyramid, and would like to make pallets or clean cook stove like a fast-moving consumer product available everywhere. Yeah.
My name is Barbara Sumedu. I'm with Fidelity Bank. I should mention that I joined Fidelity Bank from ProCredit, which was a leading name in microfinance lending in Ghana. We recently merged with Fidelity Bank, so we're taking our expertise in the sector across to Fidelity Bank. So I'll be sharing a lot on how we're also reaching the base of the pyramid with the financial services that we serve.
Hello, I'm Peggy Dibi. I'm the head of corporate communication and public affairs for Nestlé in Central and West Africa, based in Ghana. I will talk about how Nestlé is creating shared value and also promoting healthy diets and healthy lifestyles amongst consumers.
Okay. So I will just go through a brief presentation what I have made for the audience. Yes, as I think few of you have already seen our presentation, but we'll go through it quickly. As we believe, Avalon always believe independence begins at the bottom, and that is what we are trying to promote here and talk here, the base of the pyramid. About the company, we are into three space. One is the renewable heat, second is the renewable power, and third one is the renewable fuel, that is the liquid fuel, and then we here going to talk about pallets and the clean cook stove, what we are trying to promote. Overall objective of Avalon is to create energy access globally, and energy has always been the driving force for any economy. We have a global presence. Company comes from India, headquartered in India, having operations in Canada, Italy, and in Ghana, where we are talking about. As far as cook stove business is concerned, we have cook stove business promoted in India on a grand scale and a very strong distribution network, and same similar models we would be also trying to promote in Ghana and West Africa. Our operations, if you see, these are our pallet plants globally, and we started I think 6 years ago in 2009 with a pilot plant of 18,000 tons and right going up to 130,000 tons a year. So today, as a company, we have manufacturing or a processing capacity of 300,000 tons of pallets. Along with, we have a clean cook stove factory, pallet-based clean cook stove factory coming up in India. Power projects. Yes. Now, these are the various models which we are promoting right in India and also in Ghana. And based on the target segment and based on the geographical locations, we have tried to put up our pallets into various brand names. What is in Italy, we call it at, or in the European market, we call it at Pelexo. In India, we call it at Eco Shakti. The same brand we are trying to convert into Ghana as Eco Pallets. And then we call it pallets into Canada market. And from the domestic segment, that is a residual segment, up to the commercial, industrial, SME, we have various range of products available to you. About Avalon Ghana, we are the pioneer company to set up the pallet manufacturing here in Ghana and West Africa. And we have created, you can say, value from waste to value model, creating economies. And in Ghana, we have a capacity of 100,000 tons. We have recently been awarded for our Ghana model from end to end, that is collecting the waste, processing the waste, and further giving the same pallets into the market for energy generations or heating applications or cooking applications in the cook stove business. And that was for the innovation. This is our facility in Ghana, what we have, 300 kilometers upcountry from here. These are our various brands and packaging, because as you want to move further to the base of the pyramid, based on the geography, based on the target segment, you're trying to change the name, change the packing, and what we have done. You can see some of the names in the Europe, Ghana, and India. And based on that, we also change the packaging. Like in India, we make it 25 kilo. Europe market looks for 15 kilo. And in Ghana, we are still promoting 15 kilo, but yes, to reach the bottom of the pyramid, we are sure that further we have to break down this 15 kilos into maybe 7 kilo or 5 kilo or maybe even 1 kilo. So as our learning goes further, we'll be able to decide on that. These are the quality specifications, what we are trying to achieve with the pallets. These are our various models. The first one, we call it as Atom. And as far as India market is concerned, we never targeted a domestic or residential market in India, because the clean fuel like LPG has much, much more penetration and spread compared to the African nations. So this Atom model or a domestic model is being specially developed for African market, starting with Ghana and further to be spread various part of Africa, which can do the cooking for 6 to 8 people average, which is a normal family size in Africa. Second one is, I think people sitting from Ghana or Africa would know what specifically chop bar means. These are the small joints or commercial joints which prepares on the roadside for the people, or ranging between 50 to 100 people cooking every day. So this model was also specially developed for Africa, which can run for almost like 1.5 hours and do a very efficient and cost-effective cooking. Second, these are the two models which goes to the institutional and commercial levels. So where you are going to cook for 200 plus people, like canteen, or a big restaurants, or a traditional joints where people come and have a lot of foods, and a lot of food has been cooked. The other model is called institution, is a continuous feeding. So somebody, if you want to willing to do cooking for 10 to 12 hours, I think this pallet would be much more sufficient, or this stove will be able to continuously cook for 12 hours. Some industrial applications like burners we can use in the bakery sectors, or the ovens, milk boiling, flour drying, cassava drying in Ghana or in West Africa, and plus an industrial type burner. So if somebody want to deviate or divert from conventional fuel like diesel or gas, can easily shift with help of our boilers to pallets. I think very commonly used fuel, I think everybody knows that, charcoal, firewood, agriculture residue, which are used in raw. And we are trying to replace that with help of this clean cooking technologies or gasifying technologies. Coming to the pallets, I think we as a company try to promote that over and above LPG, yes, we have got another subsidies, or you can say another substitute of conventional fuel, which is much cleaner. Fine, being a solid fuel, you can't 100% claim that it's a clean fuel like LPG. But yes, compared to other conventional fuel like firewood or charcoal, I think we have a better sustainability, because we made it from various type of waste and process it, clean it, densify it. It's very efficient in cooking technology. Clean and economical fuel, yes, we definitely always, whatever you give the benefit, the customer will always look for economy. And we try to provide economy and saving of 10 to 20% for their applications, and very user-friendly. It gets adjusted into their own technology very simply. These are the benefits, what our major USP is, over and above the cost saving. So that is no indoor air pollution, I would say almost nil, no smoke, then you have no risk of hazards or accidents like a gas stove, very easy to use, adjustable in the existing system. You don't need to do any changes, time saving and cost saving also, a very economical saving of 15 to 20%. Our overall marketing strategy, if you talk, our approach is giving cooking solutions. So it's not only targeting one segment, we try to target institutional, residential and commercial sectors also. Wide range of equipment, as you all gone through, we have from domestic sector up to the big boiler, we have wide range of equipments available. before we go into the market or before we talk to the customer, we do very intense mapping of every customer or what is the cooking practice or each and every customer, not only as a group, but every customer, especially for the institutional and the commercial one. One-to-one selling goes more better for us. Affordability, yes, being new technology, pallet-based gasifier stove with sophistication, regulation, flame control, the price is always a challenge against the $20-$30 stove. So we have both the options available for the customer at the base of the pyramid. He can rent out, he can lease out, he can do part payment, so all options are open. Access, we have a strong sales distribution network of 90 sales team going across the place along with the 70 distributors across the country. Availability, we try to make available our pallets uninterrupted through our retail, but distributor and wholesale channel from where the customer can pick it up, or we may have option to deliver also. That is one of the most, you can say, most appreciated proposition what we give to the customer that come and deliver. So that's going very well. And after sales service, because our equipments are a little bit more sophisticated, after sales service, new technology, so hand holding to the customer is also required. So we have around 45 team member direct with the company working on the after sales service of this all store which are into the market. These are some examples or success stories we have in Ghana, from small store to big store, all type. And I think this is a special interventions which we have done, which we have able to do it to reach to the one of the big industry what we have, that is the baking. I think people, most of this is a traditional way how you bake bread here in Africa or in West Africa, that is creating a dome, firing it for 9 hours, and then you start baking the bread. But we, with help of our burners, we did. The task is very simple. We do it in 2 to 3 hours with the same change in their existing system. And they are as a cost effective, and we are putting them into the market. So yes, baking sector also, we have done it, which we didn't do in India, but yes, in Africa or in Ghana, we are trying to promote that. And another alternates, what we are trying to do, converting a gas-based deck oven into a pallet gasifier-based deck oven, and giving economics, this is very clear working on economy. What we have won, that's it. Thank you.
Thanks, Pragnesh. May I request Peggy from Nestle to present her.
Okay, so in the Central and West Africa region, Nestle has started operating since the 1950s, and our regional headquarters is based in Ghana, overseeing 22 countries here, from Senegal to Chad. We manage 7 factories, and we employ more than 6,600 people across the region. And we manufacture more than 85% of our product. So mainly the product that we sell in this region to millions of consumers are made locally. We are committed to offer healthier and tastier food and beverage product. And what is important in our strategy is really to ensure that the product that we offer to consumers really meets the local taste and the local needs. So for example, if you want to take the Maggi product in the culinary sector, the taste of Maggi in Nigeria is really different from the one in Côte d'Ivoire or the one in Ghana. Because in Nigeria, for example, in the local habit, they use a lot of soya fermented to enhance the taste of the meal. And we use the same fermented soya for Maggi. And in Ghana, for example, is more the shrimp taste. And in Côte d'Ivoire, it will be the classic Maggi product. So we do have coffee. We have a coffee factory in Côte d'Ivoire, one factory for this region, selling product also across the region and out of Africa. We have dairy factory also here in Ghana at Tema, where we manufacture our ideal product, the evaporated milk, and also the infant cereals. So all the cereal-like products sold in the region are manufactured locally in Ghana. We have a Milo plant in Ghana and Nigeria also. So for Milo, we sell the chocolate powder here in Ghana, and the product is sold across the region. And we have another business that is called Nestlé Professional, and this business is taking care of all the out-of-home cooking. What is creating shared value for Nestlé? We believe at Nestlé that to ensure the success of our business, we have also to create value both for our shareholders and also for the society. It means that we should always see the opportunities where we can make intersect the societal challenges and the business needs. When you look at the pyramid, for us it starts by compliance. Compliance is how we can be really compliant with regards to the local law, the international laws, our business principles, and our code of conduct. So first, when you comply with all the laws, then we can ensure that we have the sustainability of our business. And for us, when we talk about sustainability, it's really to meet the needs of the present generation without compromising the need of the future generation. And at the end, we will be able to create shared value. So we have identified at Nestlé three areas where we think that we can create value for our shareholders and also for the society. These are nutrition, water, and rural development. In our region, we have been able to create shared value. When I say in our region, is in the Central and West African region. Because when you look at the key societal challenges here in this market, the double burden of malnutrition and low socio-economic conditions are really prevalent, whereas we need healthy consumers today and tomorrow who can afford our product. In West Africa also, the productivity in agriculture is really low, and we lack infrastructure. Whereas also, we source good quality and quantity of product we need for our factory. And then we need to reach consumers through entrepreneurial business model. And we have to integrate also the youth unemployment aspect. What have we done so far? At a global level, we have made 38 commitments around the different areas, nutrition, water, rural development, environmental sustainability, and human rights. And these commitments are really global. And every year, we track our progress and we report our progress through the Creating Shared Value Global Report. Starting by rural development and the challenges in Central and West Africa, we can see that the active workforce is really in agriculture. We have more than 60% of people working in agriculture in West Africa. And the percentage of GDP providing by the agriculture is around 35%. Also, we need to look at the lack of infrastructure in rural areas, as said before, and the quality. In terms of quality, it's really important for us because if we want to offer tastier and healthier products to our consumers, given that we manufacture the product locally, we need high quality raw material. And so far, the quality of the raw material that we source before was really a big challenge. And we have been able to implement a lot of programs. For example, the Grain Quality Improvement Program. It started in 2007 here in Ghana and has been expanded to Nigeria. We train farmers to reduce really the mycotoxin in their grains that we source for our cereal-like product. So on this chart, you can see so far the different rural development initiatives that we have in the region. So we have the Nestle Cocoa Plan, because you know that Nestle is a chocolate maker worldwide. We have been able to train more than 36,000 farmers in Côte d'Ivoire and Ghana. For the Nescafe, we have also a program called Nescafe Plan, because we sow the coffee in Côte d'Ivoire and we transform the coffee in Côte d'Ivoire into Nescafe brand. So we need to work with farmers there also to improve the quality and ensure the sustainability of our supply chain. And the grain quality improvement here in Ghana and Nigeria, we work with more than 55% women. Looking at the water, sanitation, and electricity challenges in our region, we know that more than 65% of the population, they don't have really good access to clean water, and sanitation shall be improved in our region. So at Nestle, what we have done, we have implemented a partnership with International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent. We started in 2007 in Côte d'Ivoire, and as of end of 2014, so last year, we were impacted 200,000 people in Côte d'Ivoire. So they were able to access clean water and also improve sanitation. In our factory also, we have reduced our water consumption by 37% since 2007 per ton of product. So what we do, we try always to reduce the water that we use in our factory, because we know that water is a big challenge in our region. For energy also in our factory, so across the region, we have reduced our energy consumption by 25% across the region for the 7 factories. And we also invest in some facilities in our factory. For example, in the coffee factory in Abidjan, we try to use the residue of coffee to produce energy instead of increasing our energy consumption. Creating job opportunities for young people. You remember that we were talking about youth unemployment as a big challenge in Central and West Africa. So we have developed a business model that is called My Own Business. Basically, it is about employing young people. We help them to develop a business model. We give them all the equipment to sell the hot coffee in the market and in the street, and they are able to earn more than $180 per month. This is more than the average of street seller. And today we have 4,500 young people working not for us, but for some distributors, operators, and they sell the coffee in the street. For women, we really empower women in agriculture. We work with women in cocoa, in cassava, in grains quality program. More than 7,000 women are really involved in the program in Ghana, and only in Ghana. And in Côte d'Ivoire, we work with women cooperative as well to have them involved in the cocoa nursery management. Compliance, we say that compliance really is for us the basics of our strategy. So we ensure that we eliminate child labor in our supply chain. And in Côte d'Ivoire and Ghana, we have built 43 schools already that helped 11,000 children to go back to school. And we have set an external system so that all of us, you can report violation of compliance through our website. So we think that doing that, we are really transparent. Now let's talk about nutritional challenges, because I think that this is the topic also today. Because when we talk about cooking, clean cooking, we have to talk about healthy eating and healthy cooking. So the challenges that we have in our region, the biggest one, is the prevalence of micronutrient deficiencies. And especially for children and women, of reproductive age. And we have also high rates of neonatal mortality in our region. We have increasing rates of obesity under 5 years, and also a high prevalence of stunting. So what do we do at Nestle? At Nestle, we foster healthy diet and healthy lifestyle through research and development. So we have a research center based in Abidjan. Is the only one for the whole Africa. And this research center really helps us to develop new products based on African raw material So for example, 2 years ago, we have launched a Cerelac product. So Cerelac is really the infant cereals product made of millet. So the millet is sourced locally in our region, and we have developed Cerelac millet for local consumers. What we did also is biofortification work. So we tried to use the raw material that are really rich in micronutrients naturally, and we use them to manufacture our product. For Fortifort Good, we market our product responsibly, and we have been the first industry company to be affiliated to Fortifort Good, and this also a way to demonstrate our transparency. Then when it comes to nutrition education and affordable foods and beverages, we have a lot of program implemented in the region, and we offer also 61% of our portfolio under the popularly positioned product. So what does it mean? What we do, we try to offer the product in a package that is really, let's say, the smallest one, and like one single serve for consumer, because we know that not all the consumers, they can afford to get, for example, a box of Nido for 2.5 kilograms. Maybe they cannot afford it because of the purchase power. So what we have single serve, 26 grams for one person. We do the same for our Maggi product. So we have Maggi cubes, only 4 grams, and we have Maggi tablets, 10 grams. And we have the same range of product for Cerelac and Milo for single serve. By the, at the end of 2014, last year, we were able to sell 153 million servings product fortified. Fortified in iron, in zinc, in vitamin A in this region. So daily, the consumers in this region were buying 153 million of fortified product. And also we have 100% of our children's product that met our Nutrition Foundation. So Nutrition Foundation is a set of criteria that we have established based on the World Health Organization to ensure that the product meets the scientific requirement. We provide also, with the support of several partners, nutrition education to promote healthy diets. So when it comes to nutrition education, we have one of our program called Nestle Healthy Kids Program. This program has been implemented in this region since 2011. And last year, we were reaching more than 76,000 kids across the region. What does this program consist of? It is really 1 hour education per week, and the teacher of the national school, they give some lesson to the children about what kind of food they have to eat, the importance of breakfast, and also hygiene, so body hygiene and food hygiene. And also we combine these lesson classes with the importance of physical activity. So we really talk about the importance of physical activity to get the healthy lifestyle. We work also with healthcare professionals. So we have been able to train 6,500 healthcare professionals to strengthen their capabilities. And we have nutrition education activities for consumers. So I will take only 2 case studies to talk about all the nutrition education activities. The first one is our direct activation through Maggi that we call Maggi Cooking Caravan. So Maggi Cooking Caravan is a Star Kitchen caravan that is nationwide in different countries. Okay, it is a platform where we create a regional contest for cook, for women, for retailers, and they have to demonstrate their talent in cooking. And this caravan is implemented within several weeks in different countries. So for example, at that time, we have a caravan in Senegal, and they're starting the step in Koualak today. So during this caravan, what are the activities that we are implementing? So first, the target, we activate consumer, shopper, and trade partners. And in terms of activity, what are they doing? So we have some nutritionists also who take part of this caravan. So they manage nutrition classes with around nutrition, health and wellness. So they have to teach the different beneficiaries about the importance of having a very healthy diet or healthy lifestyle. They also target women's forum, because in rural communities or in town, we have women association. So they do activity with women association to talk about healthy eating. So they have to also to explain, for example, to women, when we use Maggi products, which contains already salt, no need to add salt when you cook, because you have to really reduce your salt intake. Or for example, when you cook for your family, you really have to take into account the portion guidance and also vegetables, carbohydrates, so all this stuff around nutrition. And the last one is about cooking contest. So when they do the cooking contest, it is really on live. So you have the different women, they have to prepare healthy cooking, healthy dishes, sorry, and we have to nominate to vote the winner of the day. And when we do this contest, we provide them with gas cooker, gas cylinder, cooking instances, water, and all the vegetables that they want to do the contest. In terms of second activation, so the first one was a direct activation on the ground. The second one is also through digital platform. So in September, October, we have launched a corporate social media education program to really help consumers or users via social media to reduce their salt intake by making only simple and healthy choices. So we provided them some tips to reduce the salt intake. So for example, instead of adding more salt, you have to use more spices. This is just an example. And we providing them some example of spices they can use to enhance the taste of their dishes. So we implemented this social media campaign through our Facebook page, YouTube, our website and Twitter platform as well. And we have been able to reach 11 million users only in 4-6 weeks. So we think that it is also another way to interact directly with consumers, and they reply, they raise a concern, and we have to provide also more information to build their knowledge. And this campaign was based on our two commitments here, so boost healthy diets and lifestyle, and also reduce salt in our product, because we have this commitment to reduce salt in our product and even sugar worldwide, and also how we can really boost healthy diet and lifestyle for consumers and also for all the stakeholders we interact with. So basically, these are what I would like to share with you. Thank you.
Thanks, Peggy. Can I request you to share something about your organization, Coco King, extempore, and then pass it on to you? And then we'll open up
very briefly. Okay, I will be very brief, because I didn't plan on any presentation. My name is Albert. Albert Osei. I'm with Coco King Limited. What we do is we're trying to provide value on our local products. We're trying to add value to our local products, as in food that we already eat. So we are within the breakfast market at the moment, but we're looking to transcend to the all-day market. We've been in existence for 7 years. Currently serving around 5,000 people every morning, and then also doing corporate work catering and off-site catering for corporates. I think I would leave the rest for the question and answer session. As I said, I didn't prepare for any sort of long presentation. If you have any questions after the meeting as well, you can also get in touch with me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll also try to be brief. Fidelity Bank is a wholly Ghanaian-owned financial institution. We started a couple of years ago, 12 years ago, as a discount house. We quickly metamorphosed and acquired a banking license. When we started, I think it was heavily from the discount house operations, heavily into corporate banking activities. Over the last few years, we have gradually worked our way into the lower end of the market with different initiatives. So as a bank, we've existed for about 9 years. We're currently operating from 75 branches in 9 regions across Ghana, and our operations are only in Ghana. I said we're, I think, the largest privately owned bank in Ghana at the moment. So 75 branches in the 9 regions. Upper West is the only region where we are not at. By the close of next year, we should be in the Upper West region. Now, regarding our delivery, we have structured our business so that the entire value chain of all customer groups that require banking services are addressed. So at the top, you'll find our corporate banking department or directorate, but you'll also drop down the next level to our commercial and SME segment, and then to the personal space for private individuals, but as well for the last 3 years into a segment that is new to the Ghanaian market, inclusive banking. So the target group that is way lower, completely at the base of the pyramid for customers that are not well documented, they don't have all of what it takes to open a bank account traditionally. So we're serving the bottom of the pyramid with our agency banking model. Fidelity Bank is the only bank that has authorization of the Bank of Ghana to do that. Basically, it is banking at your corner store. So you can have a bank account open at the pharmacy in your neighborhood. You can make deposits and withdrawals at that pharmacy. Simple banking transactions can be done right in the corner. So in 5 minutes, you can open a bank account on the street and transact without having to come to a typical banking or banking branch. We find that this gives us a lot of access to the lower end of the market because it is really capital intensive to put up branches across the country. So at the moment, we're working with nearly 400 agents. We're signing them on every day. So agents authorized to do banking business or on behalf of Fidelity Bank. And as well, we use the agents on the much lower level, but as well, the spread of microfinance institutions we also find is a way to get access to more people requiring banking services. So with our network of microfinance institution customers, our support to them trickles down to their customers, which happen to be a lot of the time at the lower end of the market. So 400 MFIs we're currently working with, getting to that end of the market, as well as 400 agents that we have. Close of last year, we had about 800,000 customers only on the agency banking platform. So when you move up this platform, then you have entered the personal banking space. So most of the time we're serving them through a typical brick and mortar branches, but as well heavily in the last few years with the e-services. Fidelity Bank has partnered with IBM for the next couple of years to support our technology innovation so that we can bring banking services closer to people, or to personal customers especially, on a mobile phone, over the internet, just to bring it a bit closer to home. When we go up from the personal banking space, we enter the commercial space, but more in the MSME sector. So micro businesses, small and medium enterprises. There also, Fidelity Bank, recognizing that the expertise was low, had a strategy and acquired ProCredit Bank. ProCredit was a member of the ProCredit Group, which was a global institution specialized in financial services provision to the MSME market. So following acquisition, ProCredit has integrated into Fidelity its model for working with that target group. And so that SME agenda is also being driven heavily after that acquisition. And then when you move past commercial and SME, then you go to the slightly more structured corporate customers. And there also Fidelity Bank has been very instrumental, especially with projects that matter to Ghana. So being a Ghanaian bank, we're very interested in projects that make a difference in the Ghanaian sector. So transactions in the energy space, oil and gas space, infrastructure development space, that's where we're very active in. I think our biggest challenges at the bottom of the pyramid have to do with informality. So we have tailored our approach to keeping in mind how informal the businesses on the base of the pyramid are and how to structure a credit technology that supports the nature of that segment. Over time, I think at the moment, the agency banking has been working more on introducing the lower base of the pyramid into the banking segment. Over time, I think as we develop more products and services, we can also do certain micro loans that can be catered for with the same network of agents, et cetera, that we are building at the moment. I think I will summarize it like this.
Thank you, Peggy. Thank you, Barbara. Thank you, Albert and Pragnesh. Good cross-section of people from the industry, giving us a rundown of the various the marketing innovations and initiatives that they have been doing in their organizations. Now, we have another 10 minutes for you to put up your questions to the speakers, and they would be more than happy to share their experiences and answer to your questions. So, any questions, you can put your hand. Yeah.
Thank you. My name is Manuel. I'm from Mozambique. I'm working with Levaningo, an environmental organization. I have some comments and also kind of question. First, to say that I'm not happy with presentation from Nestle. They were promoting more their products than what I was thinking. Why I'm saying that is, if we look for the perspective, why are we here promoting improved cook stove, is because we have three big issues: health, environment, and social issues. And we connect also with economic issues. And when I was seeing the caravan, where are you developing those caravan? Is where people are dying because of inhalation of smoke in the rural area. Do they achieve your products there? Is what we want to do here, we are doing here. I don't agree with your presentation. And you say that one of your goals is to employ the employment of the young people. Do you think that youth or young people need to go around the street selling coffee until where? Should you not give them more to capacitate them in terms of education? Because that is the problem, actually, what we are facing with in the rural area. Women are still using a three-stone stove because they don't have information, they don't have education about the impacts of the of using that normal kind of stove. And you were saying about you cut 25% of emission. I would like to know how first, and to show where you were before. And after, I will make my question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your attention, because I think that you really listened to the presentation. The panel that it's about how we really market consumers. So of course, if you talk about marketing, you have to talk about how we interact with consumers to reach our business goal first. And secondly, how we can foresee opportunities or maybe synergy when we talk about clean cook stove. You see why I presented the Maggi cooking caravan, just an example. So when we have this caravan, we teach women how to cook in a healthier way. So, and I mentioned that when they do, for example, the contest, they use gas. Is it a synergy or a platform where we can interact with Global Alliance? This could be a debate later on. Secondly, your question about youth employment. We have a lot of initiative around young people. So we have my own business program, and when we say young, 25, they are adults, and they are not part of our 6,500 employees. They are employed by an operator to do this activity. But in Nigeria, for example, we have a training center for technicians. So we train young people just dropped out of school. We provide them capacity in technical skills, and later on, they are sent to Switzerland to work in our factories there. I didn't highlight it here, but it is part of our activities. In agriculture also, we think that if we have a lot of opportunity to work with youth in agriculture, it is good for us and good for the country. And it is also something that we cannot do alone. We need to work with government. So everything I have presented here, we have partners. So for example, for the Healthy Kids program, it is an unbranded program. It is not Nestle who is teaching lessons to children. It is done by the teacher themselves. And we partner with the Ministry of Health and Ministry of Education, and this is embedded in the curricula. So this is an example. So for agriculture, what we do, since we work with farmers, we have a lot of young people also. They own farms themselves, and we provide them with high-yielding plantlets in cocoa and coffee. Maybe it was not highlighted here, but this is one of our initiatives as well. And the last one about gas emission. Yes, we reduced by 25%. I don't have the exact number of where we are, but I have the tracking since 2007. And what we do, we try to replace, and I give the example of the coffee factory, for example. We use some of the residues of coffee, what we don't need for the coffee itself, and we use them to produce energy in our factory instead of using the normal one. So I hope that it's helpful. As a caravan is once a year, but we have other activities. The caravan that we do, Maggie Caravan, it is for 4 weeks to 6 weeks in the year, but from one town to another one. So we have really a caravan. So for example, in Senegal, they started in Dakar, then they went to Thiès, after they went to Kaolack. And when we do this one, yes, it is branded, because when we talk about cooking in our business, it is more culinary product. But we have to think about the impact also for the consumers. We don't sell the product when we do the cooking caravan, but they have the opportunity to interact with a nutritionist. We can talk to them about the healthy diet, healthy lifestyle. Maybe is it an opportunity to have someone we talk to them about the cook stove? It is an area to foresee. Okay, thank you very
much. Thanks, Peggy. I'll just go to the lady.
All right, thank you. My name is Giftibaba Asma, member of Ghana Alliance for Clean Cookstove. My first question goes to Nestle. From your presentation, we can see that a lot of people are feeding on your products, like my earlier brother said. So they are using, have you been doing survey to know the kind of stove or energy they use to cook your products that you are trying to disseminate to over millions of people in the world? Now, do you have any, let's say, intervention to support people who are using unhealthy stoves, because you are looking at health and then nutrition? Do you have any intention to support those at the grassroots to have access to your products? Because, like I said earlier, most of the women at the villages or the rural communities are using the tray stone and the old type of cooking. So what kind of intervention are you coming up to ensure that the people are healthy, eating your food as well as using energy to cook those food? Then my next question goes to Fidelity. Fidelity, we want to know, do you have any dedicated desk for energy? Because microfinance or your SME will come, but the same procedure, the same interest rates, the same everything. But looking at the energy sector or the industry now, if we go through the same process and the same interest rates, it will be very difficult for people to access your facility. What special arrangement do you have for people in the cook stove? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Gifty. Peggy has given me the permission to start first. So, do we have a desk dedicated to energy? Yes. At the moment, we have an energy, oil and gas desk. There are three in one, but energy is definitely featured on that desk. Very active in energy programs, energy activities. I must quickly add that that desk is sitting with the corporate desk, so it's at the top of the pyramid at the moment. But what we're doing at the base of the pyramid to support is finding, I think we have a few actually, partners in this sector who can give us funding that is more affordable to the base of the pyramid type customers. So once we're done with those things, I think we'll have options also for energy uses lower on the pyramid. At the moment, it will have to be the normal way. We have a couple of renewable energy customers even in that level, especially in the commercial and SME space. But even below this, I think that there's work we can do, and we're doing that actively.
Thank you. So to talk about, I think it is about synergy and opportunity between Global Alliance as well and Nestle. So we didn't do any study to look at the energy that these women, they use to cook. We know that they use traditional and modern. Okay, they use charcoal for some traditional food as well. And they use the LPG also. But what we need to look at together is also the economic fact of this one. So if, for example, all these women are able to afford this new cook stove, which will be economically good for them, I think that we can strengthen and push this one toward them. And also, we need to raise awareness toward this woman. So maybe this activity in terms of sensitization could be done around a pilot, a program that we can implement, but it is still, I say, opportunity. I cannot make commitment today to say, yes, we go, but we need to see mutual benefit, both for our company and yours, but I think that it is the reason why we are here today, to see synergy and opportunities maybe to work together.
Two more questions. I think we are coming close or near lunchtime.
Hello, my name is Michael Yao Ajay, the CEO and founder of Man & Man Enterprise Limited, manufacturer of cook stove, improved cook stove in Ghana. My question goes to Barbara Asumadu from Fidelity Bank. I would like to know if you understand carbon credit in cook stove business, carbon credit. And secondly, if you understand, is Fidelity ready to take carbon credit as a collateral to give loans to cook stove manufacturers who have carbon credit registered?
Ajit, I have my colleague Rose. He's at the back.
Thank you very much for the carbon credit question. I'm Daniel Frimpong from Fidelity Bank, in charge of, from the corporate banking department. We work with Cook Clean. We are now part of Ghana Alliance, and we work with Cook Clean now. We've been attending a few of your meetings. Unfortunately, I've not seen you. We are working on something on carbon credits as collateral for Cook Clean, and it will be done next year to support their, we'll give them an overdraft to support their operations. So on carbon credit, we are already aware of it. We've read a lot. We've worked with Cook Clean for some time now, and we've gone into it. That's why we joined the Ghana Alliance. Thank you. Okay, you see me later. Thank you.
One more question.
Thank you. I'm Patrick with Gosan Stove. My question is to Mr. Albert. I want to know, this forum is about marketing to bottom of the pyramid people. So I want to know your strategy that you use. You said you market over 5,000 breakfasts every day to people. So how do you, what was your strategy to get to these people? Because we are connecting that to how to get cook stoves to people, the bottom of the pyramid people. Thank you.
Okay. I must be honest, I didn't know much about your organization, as in Custos, until the last month. I was introduced to it by a colleague of yours, I'm sure. We have been serving the local market for 7 years now. Where I actually started dealing with the markets, the workers, the market woman, really somewhere in 2007, 2008. And we pretty much know, I wouldn't say the bottom of the pyramid, but I mean, I think that word is a bit diplomatic, should I put it that way. But people who need much more information, I would put it, about how you know, they can actually cook safely. The strategy is pretty simple. We would start probably with the distribution of, I would say, it might be flyers, it might be leaflets, it might be. We have about 30,000 people on our database. And it's growing every day. And this is through SMS, where we send them information about our products. We have a very strong Facebook following. We also deal with directly with our consumers on a daily basis, as in they deal with our agents, which we have about almost 200 agents dotted around the city. And in the further on the city, with regards to the rural areas, I'm not sure we can. We are actually there strongly yet, so I can't see us really going there apart from using our suppliers, who are the farmers, where we get our grains, our millet, our corn, to actually transcend that information forward. So for us, I think it would probably start from our customers. Who are not necessarily your, some of them are middle income earners, but a lot of them too are on the lower end of the economic scale. And I think probably I would say a 3 to 6 month campaign would probably get a lot of people aware of what you guys are trying to do. Because as I said, I wasn't much aware of it myself. Until recently. And I think it's a very, very laudable position. But it's not even just in our rural areas, because a lot of the market people I deal with, they still use the 3-point stoves. I know that because I've been there with them. And I can see easily. I think it's also to do with flexibility. I mean, the information has to go down. And the strategy really has to be from the markets. The markets are where you start, because that's where everybody goes. You'll be surprised. But the lower income earners, that's where they go. They go to the markets. And as Nestle pointed out, they go around with these muggy tracks. I think it's a very smart move, because that's where they are. You would get much more people to understand and push the concept much further that way. But then, yes, I mean, this is simply where we would start from. I'm sure we would move on from there, but I mean, considering the stats, that's where I think we would actually do. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, speakers. Really honored to have you all, a real good cross-section of people from the private sector, from the banking sector. Thanks, audience, for being so, I would say, responsive and asking the right kind of questions. And let us not end our discussion here. I think if you have any specific questions for the speakers, you can always go offline, you can keep in connection with them. Because at the end of the day, we must realize one thing for the sector. It's so important to engage with the private sector. The private sector has the expertise of marketing. The private sector has the resources. They have the skill sets. And they can only bring in value onto the table. So I think it's going to be a win-win situation if the cook stove sector and the private sector and the fast-moving consumer goods sector all come together. It's going to be a strengthened side and is going to be a future with a lot of positives. With that, thank you very much, and I think lunch is ready.